and to suffer death on the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Because God is God, the cross is transformed ultimately from an instrument of death to an instrument of life. We proclaim the victory of God on the cross. Hence, today is called God's Friday, Good Friday. The victory of the cross is especially certain the way John tells his story of the death of Jesus. So in this very first section, the reader hearkens back to Moses out in the wilderness. He comes across this burning bush. God is in the burning bush. Moses asks, "What's your name?" God says, "My name is I Am, I Am." That phrase, I Am, refers to the God of Moses. God is present in Christ going to that cross. So in this episode of the arrest of Jesus, we hear the mention of the great I am three times, so we are sure to get it. After Jesus has said this prayer, he left with his disciples and went across the Kidron Brook. There was a garden in that place, and Jesus and his disciples went in. Judas the traitor knew where it was, because many times Jesus had met there with his disciples. So Judas went to the garden, taking with him a group of Roman soldiers and some temple guards sent by the chief priests and the Pharisees. They were armed and carried lanterns and torches. Jesus knew everything that was going to happen to him. So he stepped forward, and Jesus asked them, "Who is it you are looking for?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they answered. "I am he," he said. Judas the traitor was standing there with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they moved back and fell to the ground. Again, Jesus asked them, "Who is it you are looking for?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they said. "I have already told you that I am he," Jesus said. "If then you are looking for me, let these others go." In the ancient world, asking questions was a way of asserting dominance from one person over the other. If I ask you a question, I'm asserting my dominance over you. At the interrogation of Jesus, Jesus turns the tables. He asks the questions. When the Roman soldiers with their commanding officer and the Jewish guards arrested Jesus, tied him up, and took him first to Annas. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had advised the Jewish authorities that it was better that one man should die for all the people. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, "I have always spoken publicly to everyone. All my teaching was done in the synagogues and in the temple, where all the people come together. I have never said anything in secret. Why then do you question me? Question the people who heard me. Ask them what I told them. They know what I said." When Jesus had said this, one of the guards there slapped him and said, "How dare you talk like that to the high priest?" Jesus answered him, "If I have said anything wrong, tell everyone here what it was. But if I am right in what I have said, why do you hit me?"
Thank you.
Yes, Jesus is a king, not a king through military might, not a king of empires. The kingdom of Jesus is much more vast and complicated. Jesus is king in human hearts, king of our hearts. To underscore his identity as God's king of our hearts, John repeats that word 4 different times. Early in the morning, Jesus was taken from Caiaphas' house to the governor Pilate's palace. The Jewish authorities did not go inside the palace, for they wanted to keep themselves ritually clean in order to be able to eat the Passover meal. So Pilate went outside to them and asked, "What do you accuse this man of?" Their answer was, "We would not have brought him to you if he had not committed a crime." Pilate said to them, "Then you yourselves take him and try him according to your own law." They replied, "We are not allowed to put anyone to death." Pilate went back into the palace and called Jesus. "Are you the king of the Jews?" he asked him. Jesus answered, "Does this question come from you, or have others told you about me?" Pilate replied, "Do you think I'm a Jew? It was your own people and the chief priests who handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom belonged to this world, my followers would fight to keep me from being handed over to the Jewish authorities. No, my kingdom does not belong here." So Pilate asked him, "Are you a king then?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. I was born and came into the world for this one purpose, to speak about the truth. Whoever belongs to the truth listens to me." "And what is truth?" Pilate asked. Three times Pilate affirms the innocence of Jesus. In the middle of this narrative, Pilate displays Jesus for the crowd with that phrase, "Look, here is the man, ecce homo," in Latin. In other words, yes, here is the man, here is the human person. All that God had hoped for humanity to become, it's embodied in this Jesus. All that God had intended for us to be, people of healing, people of reconciliation, people of mercy, people of compassion, it's embodied in the human person, Jesus. When we're in relationship with him, we put on our own best selves. Then Pilate went back outside to the people and said to them, "I cannot find any reason to condemn him, but according to the custom you have, I always set free a prisoner for you during the Passover. Do you want me to set free for you the king of the Jews?" They answered him with a shout, "No, not him. We want Barabbas." Then Pilate took Jesus and had him whipped. The soldiers made a crown of thorny branches and put it on his head. They put a purple robe on him and came to him and said, "Long live the King of the Jews." And they went up and slapped him. Pilate went back out once more and said to the crowd, "Look, I will bring him out here to you to let you see that I cannot find any reason to condemn him." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Look, here is the man." When the chief priests and the temple guards saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him, crucify him." Pilate said to them, "You take him then and crucify him. I find no reason to condemn him." The crowd answered back, "We have a law that says he ought to die because he claimed to be the Son of God." When Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid. He went back to the palace and asked Jesus, "Where do you come from?" But Jesus did not answer. Pilate tried to find a way to set Jesus free. But the crowd shouted back, "If you set him free, that means that you are not the emperor's friend. Anyone who claims to be a king is a rebel against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he took Jesus outside and sat down on the judge's seat in the place called Stone Pavement. It was then almost noon of the day before the Passover. Pilate said to the people, "Here is your king." They shouted back, "Kill him, crucify him." Pilate asked, "Do you want me to crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "The only king we have is the emperor." Then Pilate handed Jesus over to them to be crucified. Pilate unwittingly becomes the world's first evangelist. The tradition in Roman crucifixion was to write out the charge and place that charge above the crucified's head. Pilate wrote the charge out, "The King of the Jews." He was probably being smirking and sarcastic when he wrote that out. But he had it written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. Hebrew, the language of religion, especially local religion. Latin, the language of commerce, economy, statesmanship, engineering, Rome. And Greek, the language of philosophy. The totality of the human culture could understand the identity of Jesus. Hebrew, Latin, Greek. No uncertainty, clear as could be, who Jesus is. So they took charge of Jesus. He went out carrying his cross and came to the place of the skull, as it is called. There they crucified him. And they also crucified two other men, one on each side, with Jesus between them. Pilate wrote a notice and had it put on the cross. "Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews," is what he wrote. Many people read it, because the place where Jesus was crucified was not far from the city. The notice was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. The chief priest said to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but rather, 'This man said I am King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written stays written." After the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier. They also took the robe, which was made of one piece of woven cloth without any seams in it. The soldiers said to one another, "Let's not tear it. Let's throw dice to see who will get it." This happened in order to make the scripture come true: "They divided my clothes among themselves. They gambled for my robe." And this is what the soldiers did. When John tells the story of Jesus, Jesus is not a hapless victim. He's very much in charge, running the narrative. In this episode from the cross, he gathers his church. His mother is there. His beloved disciple, John, is there. He makes sure that each one sees the other. To the disciple, he says, "Behold your mother." To the mother, he says, "Behold, this is your son." And John took Mary into John's house. Mary here symbolizes the church. John symbolizes the church's offspring. You and I are all offspring of the church. You and I are all mothered by the church. Church is precious, tending community that Jesus establishes as pattern from his cross. Standing close to Jesus' cross were his mother's sister, Mary, wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Jesus saw his mother and the disciple he loved standing there. So he said to his mother, "He is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "She is your mother." From that time, the disciple took her to live in his home. When Jesus says, "It is finished," he uses an economic term of the day: paid in full. All our grief, all our pain, all the chaos, all the penalties for that, paid in full. And when Jesus dies, he's very much in command of his own dying. He bows his head and he gives up his spirit. He's not a victim. He bows his head. He gives his life breath back to God the Creator. Before that, Jesus said he was thirsty, and they gave him some cheap wine. They didn't ask, do you prefer Beaujolais or Rosé? It's good this time of year. The wine they gave him would have been vinegar, would have been the bottom of the barrel wine, the leftover wine, the wine that was just the dregs that would make you sick. When Jesus takes this cheap wine, he willfully consumes the dregs. What is despicable, what is undesirable, what is just plain icky, Jesus takes that in. Our less than shining moments, the moments when we embarrassed ourselves, the moments when we felt ashamed, Jesus takes it in. He drinks it in on his cross. Please stand. Jesus knew that by now everything had been completed, and in order to make the scripture come true, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A bowl was there, full of cheap wine. So a sponge was soaked in the wine, put on a stalk of hyssop, and lifted to his lips. Jesus drank the wine and said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. From the cross of Christ emanates an image of the sacraments. The soldier plunges the spear into the side of Jesus. Blood pours out and water pours out. We see water, we think of the water of holy baptism. We see the blood and we think of Jesus at Holy Communion. This wine is my blood. Blood, wine, holy communion. Water, holy baptism. The means of joining us in relationship to Jesus. Those means are poured out on his cross, from his cross. Then the Jewish authorities asked Pilate to allow them to break the legs of the men who had been crucified and to take the bodies down from the cross. They requested this because it was Friday, and they did not want the bodies to stay on the crosses on the Sabbath, since the coming Sabbath was especially holy. So the soldiers went and broke the legs of the first man and then the other man who had been crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead. So they did not break his legs. One of the soldiers, however, plunged his spear into Jesus' side, and at once blood and water poured out. This was done to make the scripture come true. Not one of his bones will be broken. And there is another scripture that says, people will look at him whom they pierced. One of the reasons Jesus came was to help people do the right thing. To this day, he helps us do the right thing. Even at his death, he's helping people do the right thing. Joseph of Arimathea comes to procure the body. And then a character named Nicodemus also shows up along with Joseph of Arimathea. We saw Nicodemus way back in chapter 3 of John's Gospel. Nicodemus approached Jesus in the thick of the night. He was afraid. He was embarrassed. He drew conversation from Jesus, and he learned about God's mission in this universe through Jesus. Nicodemus was timid and shy and uncertain at the beginning, skeptical, unknowing. But now by gospel's end, Nicodemus emerges. He's a hero with Joseph of Arimathea, procuring and tending gently, gratefully to the body of Jesus. Nicodemus does the right thing. Jesus has a knack for making people do that, the right thing. After this, Joseph, who was from the town of Arimathea, asked Pilate if he could take Jesus' body. Pilate told him he could have the body, so Joseph went and took it away. Nicodemus, who at first had gone to see Jesus at night, went with Joseph, taking with him about 100 pounds of spices, a mixture of myrrh in aloes. The two men took Jesus' body and wrapped it in linen cloths with the spices according to the Jewish custom of preparing a body for burial. There was a garden in the place where Jesus had been put to death, and in it there was a new tomb where no one had ever been buried. Since it was the day before the Sabbath, and because the tomb was close by, they placed Jesus' body there.
Thank you.
bidding prayer on Good Friday is rather long. You are welcome to remain seated if you wish. You're welcome to kneel if you wish. You're also invited to stand. Let us pray for the church throughout the world. For Francis, Bishop of Rome, Elizabeth, Bishop of the ELCA, Laura, Bishop of the Northeast Ohio Synod, for all those about to be baptized, for all Christians. Let us pray for those who serve in public office, for Joe, our President of these United States, for Mike, our Governor, for Dave, our Congressman, for Doug, our Mayor, for all who serve the common good. Let us pray for the ministry of the church, for all our agencies of social welfare, for evangelization of our neighbors, for our own need for spiritual renewal, for those among us who have drifted away, for Christian hearts whose love has grown cold and indifferent. Let us pray for the Jewish people and the people of Islam, for all who do not know the peace of Christ, for all who do not trust in God. Let us pray for those in special need, those unemployed, homeless, ill, recovering, fearful, especially those in uniform who bear the burden of the world's hate. Lord Jesus, you carried our sins in your own body on the tree so that we might have life. May we and all who observe this Good Friday find new life in you, now and in the world to come. Where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Finally, let us pray for all those things for which our Lord would have us ask. Our Father. Please be seated. Behold the life-giving cross on which was hung the Savior of the whole world. God invites our prayers anytime, any place. But Good Friday is a especially sacred time to pray. And so the liturgy invites us to do that, to come forward here, to kneel at the chancel rail, and to pray literally beneath the arms of the cross. I'll ask you to usher yourselves up. I ask you not to bunch up, don't be too compressed, give yourself some space. kneel and linger as long as you wish. And then after you've said your prayers beneath the arms of the cross, then on your own return to your seat. So whenever you are ready, you may begin to come forward. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you.